want to do something a little bit different this time. You know, last time I didn't really do anything, right? You know, we just kind of talked about that, and I just react, and then we just meaned away there. I almost want to go through that. In fact, I do want to go through that and explain some of the really kind of key points, actually, about the stuff, because I think there were actually a few really interesting things to talk about that in that Ekvald map tour that are actually worth going over in their own right, very much so, actually. So let's go ahead and talk about that, because we just got some big info about this new map here, the Ekvald Wilds. This is kind of one of the Kurzic zone here, very anticipated, of course, from anyone who's into Guild Wars 1. You can see all the enemy designs here too, by the way. They didn't show this stuff better this month. They actually didn't show this stuff in the tour, spoiler alert, I guess. But this guy, he's a giant tree. You've got this Jade Brotherhood faction, and you've got some Tengu coming into play as well. You've got like some cute wildlife that you saw from Guild Wars 1 there. Pretty interesting stuff there. A lot of very, very cool environments. The environmental design on this map is pretty damn, very tasty. I think this map is massive as well, by the way. It's absolutely massive. It looks beautiful. It looks amazing. Aina, as usual, made it look all pretty. You've got all these different characters, all this different type of artwork going on here as well. But there are a few things that are really worth talking about here as well. These maps are big, right? When you get right down to it, I won't necessarily show this here because it will take me a while to actually find it around. But when you see them finding POIs, there are 45 points of interest and 6 waypoints on this map. That is huge, considering that Bear in mind, you know, we have mounts now, so they've reduced the amount of waypoints significantly. So 45 waypoints. You're actually dealing with a map that's about the same size as stuff like the Desolation and a lot of the Path of Fire maps. So they're absolutely vast, right? And also a lot of verticality here. You can see that if you look through the way they have these towns set up, and going a little bit later on, you go to this cathedral style area over here. There's a huge amount of verticality on this map, which I really like, actually. You know, the Path of Fire maps were a lot kind of flatter, right? You know, they were designed for mounts, right? So they didn't really go too crazy on the verticality, like with Heart of Thorns. And it looks like they've almost actually done a little bit of a mishmash, right, across the different maps, because we saw the previous map preview with Xingjie. It was actually a bit, you know, a kind of a simple zone, right? Pretty flat, everything laid out normally, right? You just run around on your mount, go around in your boat, right? Float around in the ocean there and have a good time. This map does appear to be a little bit more, it's Tangled Depths, but it's probably not going to enrage people quite so much, right? I think that's always good. Tangled Depths, maybe a little bit too much for most people, but it looks like you're going to have a little bit of both here, right? You're going to have this idea that it is a bit of a wide open space that you can run around and explore, but also a bit claustrophobic with these structures and some underground caves as well. I think this area, I really like stuff like this, actually. I do like a bit of an underground cave situation. They show this off towards the end. They go into like the depths of the mine. Where do they go in the mine? With the amber? I'm hunting it down, guys. Where is it? Okay, fine. I can't find it. Well, you know what? I'm low energy, guys, okay? I'm weak! Unable to find it, but you know, while we actually do wait for that, guys, I mean, I'm gonna have to drop a bomb here, guys. Let's just pause that real quick. Let's just relive this moment together. I saw this. I'm actually gonna call Noxy out. You know, Noxy, she always memes me, but you know what? I'm gonna expose Noxy right now. So take a look at this. Let's go to Noxy's Twitter. Make sure we've got to go on the right Twitter here, guys. You know, there's the not safe work Twitter. Believe me, that's some fire right there. Okay, let's take a look at this. Okay. I'm gonna call it. I fucking swear Aenet will pull a troll move on us and casually announces last minute after they show us everything at EOD that Tengu is now a playable race as well. Let's go and take a look what Aenet says.
A whole lot of Tengu. That is not a hint at playable Tengu. Playable Tengu are not a thing in
Boom!
Dragons.
There are a whole lot of Tengu. I love how they just dropped that. You know, that wasn't even like a big thing. That was just right at the start. That was at the start of the stream. Just drop it down. Just nuke it. Like hit that. That's right, guys. There's no playable race in the game. You know what? It feels good, right? The copium train is finally over. And you know what, guys? I'm happy about it, right? One, you want to play as a... Look, okay, you want to be this, okay? Like, let's go ahead and take a look at these birds, right? Hang on a minute. Let's scroll back a little bit. There's another Tengu over there. Where's the owl Tengu? That's you. You want to be that, guys? No. You don't want to play as an owl Tengu. I do like that we have the owl Tengu. You've got different variants of birds attached to humanoid bodies. That is quite amusing. But listen, guys, you're not playing as an owl Tengu, right? It's not happening. It's never happening. There will never be a new playable race in Guild Wars 2. And you know what? Good. Because, you know, guys, Let me tell you a few facts about Guild Wars 2. It takes them like 6 months to make an armor set because they have to do it for every single race, make it work with everything else. Guys, it takes a long time to make armor and weapons and new animations for every single ability in the entire game. Look, we already struggle with content. We already don't get enough content in Guild Wars 2. Do you want to make that even worse by making them have to create an entire new starter area, new story to make that make sense, loads of new animations, loads of new everything with every single specialization in the entire game, by the way? No, you don't want that, guys. It wouldn't be good. It would be bad, right? It would massively handicap the amount of content that came out with the expansion and hamstring the amount of stuff they could make. Not good, right? Don't worry about playable races, worry about playable content, right? Boom, there it is. Actually, while we're here, guys, not only do I see that rat, okay, I also see some pretty interesting things. They're kind of hinting at maybe some stuff with the mastery here. You'll notice here that you can see jade batteries and all the waypoints of jade, kind of a nice little touch there as well. Very cool stuff. But I think the really important thing to note here, actually, is that they're kind of hinting at what's going on here with the masteries, right? They haven't showed us all of the masteries. We know that there is a jade tech-related mastery, and I'm presuming that a lot of these items, like these jade batteries and some of these jade devices that you see in this video, are part of that mastery component, and they actually do something. You charge yourself up somehow and you're going to use that now in some way there as well, but I'm sure we'll get some information on that in later streams, so we don't really know what that looks like just yet. And I think the other really, really interesting thing is that they didn't show us that much about the Xingjie meta event. They showed us a cool snake boss, but here they actually do go a little bit further, and they talk a little bit about what the meta event looks like. And I have to say, I was getting a little bit worried that they were going to go in that Path of Fire direction where you have a very exploration focused map and honestly not really much going on in terms of content. However, do not worry, my friends, that is not the case for at least this map here. It's already confirmed that there is going to be a wide scale meta event covering everything, and I think it's a very cool idea, by the way. Actually, the idea of the meta event on Ekewald Wilds is that you have these two rival gangs going about the place. They're just kind of battling each other, trying to take each other down as much as possible, and that what you have to end up doing is that you have to like destabilize both of the gangs and mess with them while they're fighting each other to make sure they don't like explode and go over the place. And as a result of that, you end up in this really, really cool element where you're actually going to encounter events, actually, where the NPCs are fighting each other, which is pretty cool. Actually, that's a really nice thing. You can see this here, right? You have the speakers fighting the Jade Brotherhood, just kind of going at it, right? They're battling each other but also battling the player, obviously, right? And the meta event is that you're going to have this massive showdown between these two factions, and you kind of play the role of the Kestrels, which is a peacekeeper faction run by Tengu and a bunch of other kind of neutral factions trying to make sure everything stays stable there as well. It's pretty cool. It seems to be a little bit like Drizzlewood Coast Plus, right? So you have this element of, you know, you have this battlefield, right? The entire map is this giant battlefield. So a bit like Drizzlewood Coast, almost crossed with Verdant Brink. So for example, they talked about how towns are going to get attacked. You'll have to respond to that and defend it. You might have to go behind enemy lines and attack while while these gangs are attacking other players there. And apparently, look, okay, we're going to have to hold them to this. I'm hyped. I want to see some hype here, guys. Let's get some hype going. But it has been claimed there is an epic culmination, an epic climax, if you will, to the meta event, which should be pretty cool there as well. You know, I'm hoping for some big bosses, hoping to see some champions, some legendary foes, maybe even giant foes that are like full-on structures. Should be pretty interesting, but it's actually a really, really good thing to see that we do, in fact, have a confirmed meta event, because I think this is one of the things that Path of Fire really didn't do very well, and ArenaNet's clearly learned from that. Path of Fire meta events, and they do get played, right? You know, Doppelganger, Pinata is fairly common to see done, but the others are kind of left decrepit. I mean, two of them are just flat broken right now. I mean, a lot of you guys will know about this, but the Maw of Torment, right? It's just a flat broken. It's been broken since launch. Doppelganger is now bugged. It's been bugged for months, right? Rendering it very annoying to complete, right? Path of Fire meta events are obviously not a priority because for ArenaNet, but bear in mind, look at HOT. Every single Heart of Thorns meta event has stood the test of time. Why? Because they're engaging, they're fun, they've got bosses, they've got great rewards, right? And, you know, they're just good to engage in, right? They're a pretty quick fire, fight some bosses, get the loot, have an epic conversation. No wishy-washy running around in circles, like pressing F, right? actual gameplay. Heart of Thorns delivered on this very, very well. Path of Fire flopped a little bit. I'm hoping that we actually see almost like a hybrid, right? I want to see the best of both worlds here. Path of Fire had awesome exploration. Playing through it for the first time was beautiful. You had stuff like the Griffin Collection. Amazing to discover that for the first time. Incredible environmental design in Path of Fire, which is definitely being matched here. You can clearly see how good the environmental design is. I mean, seriously, I would definitely recommend watching this stream. If you are watching this on YouTube, then definitely watch the live stream, because they show off some genuinely brilliant architecture and artwork throughout this. And I actually can't wait to hear the music. You didn't really hear that much of the music on this stream, because obviously they were just talking, right? They were having a discussion about this. But I think the music with this is going to be absolutely stellar. What we've heard so far from Ender Dragons is amazing. Some of the best music that's ever been composed for Guild Wars 2, for sure. And combined with the visuals, it's going to be pretty stunning. You can see the scale. This is something that I have always felt Guild Wars 2 hasn't delivered well on. It's something that when I was playing New World, was like, wow, this is amazing, is the scale. Look how small the character is here compared to these massive towering cliffs and huge structures. And that's something that this map does very, very well, which Guild Wars 2 has struggled with. You never really feel like you're a tiny character in this huge, expansive, you know, dangerous, mysterious world, which this map seems to deliver on, which is very exciting. And I really hope they continue to do this in the other maps there as well, in delivering that idea that this is a huge uncharted land. Very cool stuff here from the map artists. But this is no real surprise to me. Like, if someone said, oh wow, guys, I'm gonna leak something to you about the Guild Wars 2 expansions, right? The maps are really pretty and well designed. Like, well, and I could have told you that one for free. Like, Arena has historically always done an amazing job with their map design in terms of making it feel very, really like nailing it with how things look, the visuals, right? Except for that scale factor. Even the HOT maps don't feel massive, you know? Like, in some ways, Path of Fire did a better job because they're just flat out bigger, I guess, right? I guess that'll do it, right? Make big maps and things feel bigger. But in terms of having these really big structures, that's what I think Guild Wars 2 has been missing, and that's exactly what we see delivered here. We see this massive archaeological site here as well, and then moving towards the end, they show an amazing piece of scenery towards the end with this massive thing that I think they do like a really cool like screenshot moment towards the end, right? You know, they kind of, yeah, go for a shot here and then they look up. Wait, do we look up here? I think we take a look in a moment there. But yeah, looking at all this massive environmental design, then I think, yeah, they turn around in a minute. Turn around! Come on, show me, I want to see the clip. Right, yeah, you see this giant house over there. Then we pan the camera and we see this massive thing. Guess maybe it's towards the end a little bit more there. Oh no, I'm getting baited. You know, this is why you don't do this stuff live, guys, okay? It's, you know, I'm getting trolled here, right? I'm getting memed. But anyway, it looks pretty good. It's giant, it's massive, right? There's cool buildings, there are cool things. There's a meta event, Ekavald Wilds, looking damn good. And they haven't showed everything here as well. They were kind of teasing a little bit about where the map is going there. I mean, realistically, there's this map portal at the end that they kind of show off a little bit here. Let me refresh the VOD, and I think I actually will be able to see the proper image. See, that's how, like, we're breaking news right here, guys. We're really on the breaking news end of things here. But if you really take a look at this, at the end, they show off this portal that may or may not go somewhere very exciting. It does have the same visual appearance as a map portal, right? They showed off a few of these objectives, a few of these structures that have these portals. One even being blocked off by NPCs, which is really interesting. There's that massive towering thing there as well. This appears to just take you to a map, and it could be a guild hall. They already showed one guild hall, so it might not actually be a guild hall because, I think it might just be another open world map, but it could be almost like, it's entirely possible that they could be introducing a new type of content with this sort of thing, maybe? I mean, realistically, it's just another map, another open world map, and it just, you just lead into that, and then the other one can get closed off. But one that gets closed off to me is interesting, right? Because that almost implies that there is something more there, right? It's like, okay, what is that? Like, you can't cross to this area unless this. Well, what's the point in that unless it's something different, right? Because there's no point in having a portal closed off because you can just waypoint to the next map, right? That doesn't do anything. Like, you can simply just move there immediately afterwards or immediately before. Blocking, entrance to a different map does nothing because you can simply teleport there immediately. Okay, so what does that mean? What does that tell you? Okay, well, to me, it says that there might be something more here. It could be like an open world map, a bit like Dragonstorm, with like a scripted meta event in there or something like that. It could even be like It could be instance content, right? It could be a type of instance content that runs on a timer or is only unlocked, and you have to go in there with a squad of 50 and clear that stuff out there as well. Could be that. It could even be a smaller piece of content. It could be, it probably won't be a dungeon, not gonna lie. Not impossible, of course, but pretty damn unlikely to be a dungeon. But hey, you never know, right? You know, listen, it's a little bit of copium. Housing, I don't think there'll be player housing because they've already talked about some of this stuff. Elite mission, yeah, it could be something like an elite mission. It's not a raid. Raid portals are red and strike missions are a weird swirly blue. So it's not a raid or a strike. It's something open world, but it could be a spin on open world. It could be something like that. And I think that's exciting. They were very ominous around it. They were very like ooh, 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 right? They didn't want to drop it. They want to say, yeah, you're going to find out about that later. So it could be something a little exciting that maybe we haven't seen before, a new type of activity for players to compete, linked to open world, but not quite. We've seen them experiment with this anyway, with stuff like Dragonstone, with stuff like Dragon Response missions, where you have this instanced PvE content, a bit more like Guild Wars 1 missions, same with Forging Steel. It could very well be something like that. But on a larger scale, right? On a meta event scale. So you break through these events to unlock the gate, and then all of a sudden people can start getting into this content. You have a public map for it, just like Dragonstone, which can get completed, that has this internal adventure, like this public, almost like public dungeon feel thing. Very possible, given what they've been experimenting with in terms of their technologies recently. But yeah, I've got to say, this is a really, really cool look. I mean, as always, it's such a tease. Don't show us the meta event. A lot of the NPCs weren't shown here, right? They were only showing some of the stuff, some of the events there, right? It's such a tease. Not, and honestly, this map is big, by the way, 45 point of interest. So they have not even close to shown all of the environment there as well. And bear in mind, we're probably getting, what, 4 to 5 maps coming out with the expansion? 4 massive maps, hopefully all with meta events, hopefully all with a lot of content and some really cool environments there to explore, and maybe even some extra content. If they're adding, like, extra content, right, like almost like a Dragonstorm-style thing that you can do on every map, that would be sick. I love some of that. I think the Marionette's amazing. Dragonstorm is amazing. If they could actually keep delivering on that, that would be insanely cool, in my opinion. Like, to almost have, like, that group content experience, but on an open world map, and using some of those assets, using some of that stuff to get more bang for your buck, squeezing more juice out of this content, out of those maps, that would be amazing. Like, you know, to have both of that going at the same time, particularly if they're linked. I think it's really cool, this idea that you finish an event chain and then bam, it opens up this boss you can do, right? It really pushes that collaborative feel, and like, it creates an environment where players might feel comfortable to actually enter some instance content and get used to the idea of playing in a squad, not entirely open world. That would be awesome. Now, bear in mind, that's incredibly speculative. That is just me really going out there and dropping some bombs, okay, and saying, well, you know what? It could happen, right? And, well, I mean, it could happen, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it will happen. But I've got to say, this map looks like it's got a huge amount of flavor, lots of character, lots of personality. Very excited to actually play this. Play through this as well. It looks like a very mature version of the best of Path of Fire combined with the best of Heart of Thorns. The meta event is going to be the big deciding factor for me, like how that's going to go, how that's going to be represented and what that actually does. But I've got to say, this looks very, very promising. And the design, as always, very close to Guild Wars 1. You can see that the forest is slowly coming back to life because, you know, for the lore nerds out there, guys, basically Shiro got all mad and this forest turned into a rock. But now it's kind of turning back into plants again. You can see that greenery growing out there as well. Just perfect environmental design, by ArenaNet once again. You love to see it, guys. It feels damn good. Ekavald Wilds are here, and there's a lot more too. And of course, next week we'll be seeing about the Jade Sea, so definitely stay tuned for that, guys, showing us what's happening with the Jade Sea, how it's been liquidating. And then, of course, you'll see perhaps a little bit more of the Luxon side of things. This is the Kurzic Enjoyer zone here. But look, you know what, guys? Leave it in the comments, right? If you are a Luxon fan, I don't know, just say so, right? You know, if you like Kurziks, call them the Suxons, right? I don't know if there's like a good insult for the Kurziks. I don't even know, guys. Okay, maybe you can come up with them. But yeah, let me know, Kurzic or Luxon, you guys tell me. But anyway, that's basically all I've got to say here. You can see the meta event proccing there. The mines are under attack there. But anyway, check that out. Cur dicks, really? That's all you got, guys? But yeah, we're going to be seeing some siege turtles. We're going to be seeing, dude, siege, imagine they added siege turtles. Yeah, we baited you guys. You guys thought it was a mount? Oh yeah, siege turtles are actually the new playable race. Now that will be the energy there. That will be the content, guys. But anyway, that would be where the energy really, really is. But yeah, super exciting stuff here from the Ekavald Wilds. Lots more to come. There's more maps to explore in End of Dragons coming up very shortly. And this is going to be a big month. They're showing off a lot. The final beta coming up there with the Siege Turtles towards the end of November. Jade Sea being shown off. Legendary weapons being shown off in December. And look, let's get some hype going. Let's get some serious, serious hype coming through right now. Bring the energy. Bring the hype. That is it. Ekavald Wilds. Boom. Nice.